this. Introduction about me. I'm a startup called Trendis. We make Android applications. Apart from that, I'm also the organizer of this group called Bangalore Android User Group, or BLR. We're about 3,000 strong, right? 3,500 or more members. Biggest Android group outside. We meet once a month, we do all kinds of things around Android, we have our own meetups and stuff. So if you're interested in Android, just go ahead and join our group. It's on blr.org. Right, we have about 3,500 members.
So that's also the mailing list?
Yeah, it's on the mailing list. Just go up and sign over here, or you'll get access to the mailing list as well. So let's quickly discuss the Android app building blocks. These are the building blocks of Android. So if you want to develop any kind of application, you need to be aware of this. So let's quickly go over one by one, all of these. The first thing that we should look at is activities. I think I've talked to some of you about activities. So how many of you know what an activity is? Okay, Ashish, go ahead.
Activity is a screen?
Yes.
It's just a screen in which something happens.
Absolutely. Ashish, yeah, from your experience.
So activity is, I think, the first thing when you open an app is basically an activity gets launched and so each screen is an activity is what he is told.
Okay. So as you can see, this is like a Twitter app over here. It's the screen, the whole screen is an activity. Okay. So activity is a window where you can draw stuff. And draw stuff means you can have text, you can have images, you can have all kinds of user interfaces on top of it. Typically in an application, you have multiple activities. Right? Like for the Twitter screen, right? When you launch, you have to enter your username, your password. So that is one activity. When you enter that, you click on login, that takes you to another activity. So in an application, you'll have the main activity and then you'll have multiple other activities. Okay. So the activity is responsible for drawing the user interface on the screen. Okay. Any questions? Sir? Very simple. Like if you look at an Android home screen, that is another activity. If you're dialing a phone number, that's another activity. All those are examples of different activities. Okay. Next, intent, right? So let me give an example for this. So let's say you have your home screen, okay? And let's say you want to dial a number. So let's say you have a home screen and you want to dial a number, okay? So you click on the dialer icon over here, click on the button. What happens is it launches another activity, which is the dialing home screen. This is another activity, is that clear? Right. So what happens is the activity 1 launches an intent, okay, which enables it to go from activity 1 to activity 2. So it enables you to move from different activities, between activities. Okay. Similarly, when you enter the phone number and click on dial, it goes to another dialing screen. What happens is it launches another intent to go to that screen. That's how you can move from one screen to another screen. So if you're building any application today, you have multiple screens, you need multiple intents to move between those screens. Okay. You can also pass information between activities using intent. So for example, in this case, when you're moving from activity 2 to activity 3, you're passing the phone number. Okay. So activity 3 basically knows, okay, this is the phone number I'm supposed to dial. So you can pass information between activities using intents. Okay. The other thing you have to note is activities have a life cycle. Okay. So let's say currently activity 1 is in the front of your screen. It's called a foreground activity. Okay. Whenever you launch another activity, the activity that's there before, that goes into the background. Whereas activity 2 is now in the foreground. So activity 1 is then paused and stopped. Okay. It's put on top of a stack. It's called the activity stack. So only activity 2 is in the foreground and that is the only activity that's being processed. Okay, that's the processing is going on in that activity. So let's say if you're playing music in activity 1, as soon as you launch activity 2, the music is paused and stopped. You cannot play the music anymore. Okay. So you can only do, you should typically do UI stuff, small processing that you don't need to continue when it's paused in the activity. Don't do anything that's long term in the activity.
tabs that are there in the activity too. So,
yeah. Good question. So, so what happens is when you move to a different tab, it goes to a different fragment. Okay, these days it's fragments. In the older, this is a very old screenshot. So, what happens is this is the same activity. Even if it's a fragment, it's part of the same activity. You're not moving to another activity. It's in the same screen. The lower part is changing. Right? It's the same activity. I'll explain fragments probably a little later. So when you have multiple activities, there's an activity stack. Okay, when you press the back button on your Android phone, what happens is the foreground activity is then stopped, and then the activity that's on top of the stack, that's popped, okay, and that is shown on the screen. Similarly, this is what happens when you're pressing the back button. Yes.
I have some values on activity 1. Okay. I want to focus the operation on the values on activity 3.
Okay.
How can I communicate?
Okay, so the question is if you have activity 1 and you want to pass something to activity 3, right?
Yeah.
If you want to pass something, if you literally want to pass something, you can pass sequentially. That's the best way. You pass an intent to activity 2. Are you going via activity 2 or are you going directly from 1 to 3?
Yeah, via 2.
Via 2. So pass it to 2, 2 will pass it to 3. Okay. If you don't want to pass stuff, there are places where you can store information that's common to the whole application. You can use that, you can use databases, you can use a lot of different things. But if you want to pass stuff, I would say pass it to 2, 2 will pass it to 3. Okay. Any questions on intents? So intents is not only from activity to activity, it's also from activity to other building blocks. You'll come across services very soon. So activity, if you want to launch a service, again you'll use an intent.
One question.
Yeah.
So you can also use intents for cross-app communication, obviously.
Yes.
Sometimes I notice that the activation window which shows you recent apps gets confused about which app you're in. Like in Chrome, you open, say, share a link via Gmail.
Correct.
Now suddenly Gmail has become part of the Chrome window. It doesn't launch a separate app.
Correct.
So I'm just wondering why that happens.
So that's the way it's designed, I guess. Right.
Because sometimes it launches a separate app,
right,
sometimes it does not.
Correct. So what happens is when you do a share via intent and do that, that's part of the same activity stack for that application. So it's not completely a different application. So that's, I guess, the way it's designed. So let's look at the next building block, which is views. Okay. So till now we discussed the whole screen or how to move from screen to screen. Views are individual building blocks of Android, like individual UI building blocks. Right? So they are described in XML typically. So what happens is, in case you have a team with designers, so the coder can focus on the code and the designer can design the UI separately in an XML file. This conforms to the MVC architecture, right? So you have your code, you have your UI, and you have your data. All three are separate. Okay. So the UI is typically made in XML. And you can have all kinds of events, right? You can click on button, you can long press it, you can drag it, and so on, right? All these events are can happen on a view. So let me give you an example. So this is a Twitter application. The top part is called the action bar. Okay. So this is an image view. Okay. This is another image view, this is another image view, and this is another image view. Right? So all those are individual views. Then there are various types of views. There are image views, there are text views, there are buttons, right? There are edit text where you can enter data. All those are different types of views. If you see the row below, right? This is an image view. This is a text view. Okay. So all these are different views. And you can combine all these views together in something called a view group or a layout. Right? How they are arranged together is a layout. So you can specify that, okay, the image on the left, image has to be on the left hand side. On the right of that, you'll have a text view. Below that, you'll have another text view. The arrangement of all those views is called a layout or a view. We just call it layout for now. Okay? So in your application, you'll be writing a lot of layouts. So basically, all these individual views, you make one layout for this row. These rows combine and make a bigger layout, and so the whole UI of any activity or any screen is basically a big layout. Okay, so if you're making an activity, you have to make the UI for that activity. Basically, what you're making is the layout file for that. Okay. Any questions?
So in web, what happens is when you have like a layout or any view, then probably you, there are some parts which are dynamic to it, which you eventually pass some data from the controller, and then it gets built up and
rendering,
right? So does it happen a similar way over here also? Can I create a layout with placeholder content which I can populate?
Absolutely, absolutely. It's the same way. So you can dynamically edit stuff, update stuff, fill in data, all kinds of stuff. It's the same way. The way it happens, like the way you declare is a little different, right? Because you have the code part separate, you have the XML separate. So you can create a view in code and then inject it, right? You can do all of that stuff. But it's the same concept. Concept is.
So when you say the view is an XML, there are no placeholders there, right?
So what you can say is it's an empty layout, okay? Then you can get the reference to the layout in code and say add this view in runtime. You can get a, you can get the placeholder, you can fill anything inside it.
So I can put placeholder.
Absolutely, right? Absolutely.
There is probably
absolutely. For that. You can completely make layouts, add layouts, remove layouts, everything dynamically. So these are views. Any questions? So you can have long press, you can have press, you can have drag actions, you can do all kinds of stuff with it. Okay.
Yeah. Will this be part called a view or it will call your layout?
It will be a view group. Okay. So this is called a view group, a group of views basically, right? Together, so this view group is probably a relative here. Okay. So this is a relative layout. The arrangement of all the views is called a relative layout. So in a relative layout, what happens is you can tell how each view is arranged with respect to another view. Okay. So what happens is this whole thing is called the parent, the whole row. Okay. So the image is on the top left of the parent. Okay. This text view is on the right of this image view, and it's at the top of the parent. Okay. So so you can define each view with respect to the other view. The whole arrangement is called a relative layout or a view group. So don't worry about relative layout right now, but basically you can arrange all of those individual views too. So I'll probably show you a simple view layout and stuff. Probably it will be better. Okay. Okay, next, content providers. So content providers is a little advanced concept in Android, so let me illustrate this with an example. So let's say you build an application which is a contacts application. Right? You'll have different activities, is that clear? You'll have multiple activities in the application. Right? Maybe one activity to add phone numbers, one to display the list of contacts, one to edit, all kinds of different activities. So instead of, so where will you store the data typically, like the name, phone number, email address? Where do you think you should store the data? In a database, right? Typically you store it in a database. So instead of storing it directly in a database, in Android you use something called a content provider. Okay. So content provider is basically a wrapper on top of a database. Okay. You make it in such a way that other applications can also share that same data. So what happens is instead of directly storing in a database, you build a content provider and you store the logic of where to store the information in the content provider. Okay. So the content provider will know, okay, this data I want to store in the database, this data I want to store in a file, maybe this data I want to store in the cloud. That logic of where to store the data, how to store it, is in the content provider. Again, it's a part of your application. You have to write the code for that. But that runs on the system level. It's not only in the application level, it runs on the system level. I'll give an example of that. So what happens is, let's say activity 1.1 is for creating a new contact. You're creating, let's say, a friend's phone number, right? You go and ask the content provider, I want to store this information. The content provider has a logic of where it should be stored. Okay? It goes to the SQLite database, which is the database on Android, and stores it over there. you have programmed it in such a way. You might want to store it in a file, it depends on the thing, right? Then it's stored, right? If you have another application, this is where content providers are really useful. If you have another application, which is an SMS application. Now, traditionally in databases, if you have one application, everything is sandboxed there. Like the database is also sandboxed. Very difficult to access the database of another application. So content providers is designed to specifically solve that problem. So if you have application 2, which is, let's say, an SMS application, you need to find the phone number for a person, right? Now the phone number will be stored by which guy? The contacts application. It's not your application. You are building the SMS application. So you need access to the phone number. So what you do is you basically ask the content provider of the contacts application. Where is my phone number? Where is the phone number for this person? The content provider will have the logic of knowing where the data is stored. It will go and look in the DB or whatever, right? It will get the information and give it back to the activity, right? In your application. So similarly, if you are building in your own application, you can either just build a database, right? If you don't have a really complex app, build a database, don't worry about it. But if you want other applications, even other applications from your product suite, right? If you have a free version, if you have a pro version, if you want to share data between, right? You can build a content provider so that data sharing is like completely seamless.
So basically, when I create an app and I create a content provider, I need to basically document content provider for other apps to be able to understand how to get the data from my app.
Correct. If you want it, right? You can make it in such a way that only your apps access it, or you. So there are many users of content provider. One, the biggest one is what you said, right? The other things are like loading easily. So there's something called loaders. So whenever your page, like a list view, right, where you have a different, like in Twitter, right, all the tweets are being loaded. So there is something called loaders which make loading very easy. It's an Android component. It's an Android API. So loaders require a content provider. It's built in that way. So if you just build a database, you cannot use that. You have to build your own loading. So it's a recommended practice to use content providers. Any questions? So if you have other applications, right, if you build another application which uses the contacts, then you can, again, that application can also query the content. You can specify which applications can access the data, how they can access it. You can define the security parameters and all those things. And you might want to expose some data, like maybe if name, phone number, you might want to expose. Maybe email ID is something you don't want to expose. You can define all of that. Any questions? Yeah. Next, we look at services. So as I said, right, activities are started, they are created, they are started, and when another activity comes in the foreground, that is paused. Right? You cannot play music in an activity. As soon as another activity comes or a call comes in, that activity comes in the foreground and the music is paused and stopped. So that's why you cannot do background tasks in an activity. For that, you need something called services. They are faceless tasks that run in the background. So if you're building a music player, typically the code for playing the music would be the service. Okay? And the code for interacting with the UI, the button press, that would be an activity. So the activity would interact with the service and get the information. The service will update the activity and so on. Any questions? Next, notifications. So you've seen Android notifications, pretty simple. Very simple to create a notification, 2 or 3 lines of code. You can have visible alerts, you can have icons, you can have an expandable notification, vibration, LED notification, all different kinds of notification. Very simple to create. You have to use something called the notifications manager to create a notification. Finally, Android manifest.xml. So how many of you kind of looked at the manifest file? So manifest is it's like a catalog of all the functionality, right? Which versions of Android you should support, what are the different libraries you're using, the package name of your application, all the permissions that you might be using. Permissions are very important because, let's say, your application wants to interact with the internet. right? You're gathering some data. So for any Android application, if you want to access those special features, you need permission. So when the user downloads the application, you see the permissions, right? This application requires internet permission, Bluetooth permission. So you know before installing what are the things required. That's why you have to mention the permission. If you don't mention the permission in the manifest file, even if you download the application, install it, you've forgotten to use internet permission, it'll not work. Simply, like, the permission will be denied. Any questions? So quick walkthrough of the development environment. Eclipse is the older development environment for Android. So how many of you are familiar with Eclipse? Most of it. So quickly walk through it. The whole thing is called perspective, right? There are different windows, like the edit areas, views, all these are different areas in the perspective. So give you an example, on the left hand, on the center is where your source code will be there, right? Source code, UI elements, all that in the center. Left is the package structure. It's kind of important. I'll show you in the actual program what the package structure might look like. The bottom, you'll get all your error messages, logs, and so on. On the right hand side, you'll see all your program elements, outline of the variables you're using, the methods, and so on. So this is UI editor, simple drag and drop. I'll drag from the left hand side and put it in the center. You also have the functionality of an emulator. So create a new emulator. So what happens is, in case you don't have an Android device, you can create an emulator for any version of Android. And then it's like a virtual device where you can test your programs. Emulators are very useful because maybe you have one or two devices. You might not have a tablet or a very high resolution device. You can create all different kinds of emulator within the development environment. So it runs the actual version of Android, and you have the screen, you have the actual buttons, the whole menu, all kinds of different buttons. The new emulators are really powerful, and you can give it GPS coordinates as well, you can move it around and so on. It's pretty powerful. So let's not cover how to install the SDK. Let me quickly launch Eclipse and show you. Any questions? So what would you like me to cover, like a simple program or?
I have a small question with respect to this emulator.
Yeah.
For example, I'm creating a small contact app.
Okay.
There is a, as you said, there is a already existing application for the contacts.
Okay.
But will there be any existing contacts available inside?
Yeah, it's a good question. So there's an existing contacts application, but which comes by default, right? Open source Android application. So so that stores in a content provider which you can access. Okay. So like I showed you, right? You can create a content provider. Android has already created the content provider for you. So in case you want to add a contact, if you want to retrieve a contact, you can do that using the same content provider. Yeah. So I think there's a contact content provider. There are all kinds of different content providers which are there.
Okay. So there are some existing data.
Absolutely.
Can you able to delete those data? So my functionality intends to delete existing contacts.
Yeah.
Would that be possible?
I think so. I mean, depends on the permissions. I'm not sure if you can delete it. Yeah, we have to look it up. But it should be possible.
So, the other thing is that if I, so when I start a new project,
okay,
and then I make a new layout, so
okay,
let's say activity one. So how do I make activity 2, 3, 4 and
sure,
then link each other? And
sure. So that's a common question, I think, right? So I'll just show you how to do that. So. So when you install Eclipse, so there are a couple of development environments for Android. One is Eclipse, the other one is called Android Studio, right? It's based on IntelliJ. Eclipse is still the better platform. I mean, not the better platform, it's the more prevalent platform, and it supports more features as of now. So the newer one is better in most senses. It's like faster and got lots of really like cool features. But for now, Eclipse is really good, right? So, we'll start and create a new Android project. Let's, can't see this. Basically, what you have to do is File, New Android Project. This dialog will come up when you click on New Project. Enter your application name, project name, and so on. We'll just call it, let's call it Hack 9, right? Keep all the other values as default. and select the SDK, minimum SDK version. Click on next. So we're not changing any of the minimum version of Android.
And the package name, sorry.
Yeah.
So how important is that?
Package name is kind of important because like many people might have the same application, right? So it's important to have a unique package. So for example, if you are building a contacts application, it's XAML. So I would change the second parameter here. So I would call it, let's say I want to do it Apigee, right? Let's say I'm doing it at Apigee. So Apigee would call it com.apigee.com.
Is this like a domain name that you want?
It's not something that specific. It's based on users, right? So some people call it com dot android dot something else.
How do I know that something that I'm putting there is
already directly?
Yeah. So try to make it unique. And you cannot do that basically, right? I mean, you have to guess initially. So typically com dot organization name dot something shouldn't be occupied. You can check the market. So if you go to the Android market, it quickly. So if you see, if you go to any Play Store link, right? So the link will be there. At the end will be the package name. Okay. So you can go and check it out if your application is there. So if you go over here, let's see. You go to apps, right? Let's do some other app. Iris, right? So you can see that com.dexterra.iris.
So I just can't come here.
Yeah, you can just
place the package name that I want.
Yeah,
and then
just check
if that exists. Yeah.
So right now we'll just keep everything to its default value. So over here you can change the launcher icon and stuff. You can change it to some clip art. Something like this. Change the color and stuff. We just leave everything to its default value. The last thing is kind of important because it tells that I'm creating an activity for you. Right? What is the name of the activity? So it's creating your home screen. If you want to change the name, you can do that. It also creates a layout file. So what do you think is a layout file?
XML.
Yeah. So what does it do?
It has a
UI
for description.
For the standard line.
Yes. Correct. Right? So it's creating the activity, it's creating a corresponding layout file. Click on finish. So the other thing, so it's created this, right? Created this application. It's created the layout file. Very simple. It's got a hello world text. So what a very big program structure. So before that, I'll show you something which is kind of cool. It's called DDMS. Okay. So this is a Java perspective. There's another perspective called DDMS. You can add that. What that does is basically track any emulator, virtual device, or real device that you might have connected. So let me show you an example. So let me create a virtual device. Right? So I have many virtual devices. I'll launch a virtual device. I have many virtual devices, you can see. Let me start a virtual device. Okay, so this is the emulator, it's going to take some time to start up. Till that time, let's look at something else. Okay. So this is the button to create or view your existing emulators. On the top left, my Android Virtual Device Manager. Okay, over here you can go and create different emulator sizes. Like, if you have a 7-inch device, you can have a 5-inch device. All kinds of different devices. There are pre-existing configuration for all Google devices, like Nexus 7, Galaxy Nexus, Nexus 4, all that stuff. You can create any resolution, any kind of device over here. Okay, let's look at the program folder structure. There's a source folder, right? Any guesses what that could contain?
Source folder.
yeah, any kind of code, right? Any source that you want is to be divided, like it will be, it'll have the package name and then it will be, all the code will be divided on the server. So it will have the main activity code. So we'll have a look at that soon. So it also has different folders. It has a gen folder, which I'll come back to later. It has this resources folder, which is important. Okay. You can see that the UI, this is called activity underscore main.xml. Okay. This is the XML file that represents the layout. It's in this folder called layout folder. Okay. That folder is inside the resources folder. Right. So resources has all your resources. That might mean images. So you can see images. This is an image. Okay. So it has different image folders. So there's a drawable drawable dash HTTPI, there's MTTPI, XHTTPI, and so on. So all these are different basically resolutions, so different screen densities. So most of the recent phones are very high resolution phones. So those form under XHTTPI. If you see the Galaxy S4, HTC One, those are XHTTPI. They have a pixel density of more than 320 dots per inch. So why you need so many folders is because, let me show you. So an image in different resolutions, the same image might have different sizes for different resolutions.
Is there any quick tool which can...
Sure. So what happens is, you don't have to really manage this. Okay. So Android does this for you. Typically, in the you just put a image in the highest resolution folder, Android automatically screens it down for you. Okay. But I would still recommend there are many tools, like you go online, even there's an Asus Studio which automatically does it for all the resolutions. So you can see the same image, right? This this icon, okay, will look the same size on a very high resolution phone. It will occupy the same screen size, but you need a very high resolution image to look like that. So that's why you have different folders. And the name of the file is same, so Android knows what is the resolution or the density of the phone. It will automatically go to that folder and select that image. You don't have to do anything. It will do it in a minute. So that's the drawable folder for all the images. Any image that you have will be stored over here. Then there's a layout folder where you store the layout, the actual UI, how it looks and so on. So this is activity underscore main.xml file. When you double click on that, this is how it looks. You can have, so this is the graphical layout. There's also something called the XML layout. This is how the actual XML is. Right? You have a relative layout on the top, and inside that you have the text view. So all your layouts will be there over here. There are other different things like values and menu folders, which we can cover a little later. The Android manifest file, we discussed that, where you mention all the package names and the permissions and so on. That's over here. Again, it's an XML file. You can see that this is the name of the package, the version number, it's the minimum version of Android supported. You also have to mention all your activities over here. In case you add a new activity, you have to mention that over here. Other important thing is the gen folder. So what happens is, anytime you create any new resource, it might be an image, it might be any kind of resource, it might be a button also. Right? Whenever you do that, Android automatically updates this file called r.java. Okay? It catalogs that resource. Okay? You add a new button, Android says, I want to catalog it, that you can access it very easily later. Okay? Because the resources in this are in the resources folder. Normally you would have to import it or do something else, right? Android makes it much simpler. It will automatically, you just add the new resource, Android will generate an ID for that. So I'll give an example.
So basically you come here to get the ID and use it somewhere else.
You don't have to come here also, I'll show you how to do it, right? So for example, this is the class R. Okay. ID is called, ID. Currently there's just one ID over here. What I'll do is I'll add a new button to this layout. I'll just quickly drag and drop a button. Okay. If you go to the XML, you can see the ID of the button is button 1. Okay. So all you've done is added the button. Okay. And if you go to ID, you can see that the button 1 automatically has been added. Okay. So you don't have to do anything. Anytime you add a new resource, it will be added over. How is that useful?
If I want to add customized button like color.
You can do that. You don't have to add. So this file is always auto-generated. You don't have to do anything. Okay. Whenever you add something, it will come over here automatically.
So if I'm
you shouldn't change this file.
Not this file, the layout file.
Yeah,
file,
you can change it.
I just change it to button 2.
Yeah, it'll automatically change. Just change it to button 2, save it, go back, and you can see it's button 2. You don't have to do anything. So next, so how is this useful? Okay, let's go to the source of our program, which is main activity. Okay. You can see that, so onCreate is the method which is called when the activity is created automatically. So typically any UI initialization that you want to do, you can do it over here. Right? So what we do over here is call this method called setContentView. You set the view of your application over here. Right? So you set the view to your layout file, right? The layout file is again a resource. The name of the file is activity_layout. So let me show you that. It's r.layout.activity_layout. Right? That's a resource. So Android automatically catalogs it under r.layout.activity_layout. Right? So instead of importing it and making it complicated, whenever you want to access a resource, you can just say, like the button 2, you will get it directly like this. The reference to the button. Okay. Any questions? So let's go to DDMS. So DDMS is kind of a perspective where you can see what's happening in the device. So we launched the emulator. The emulator is kind of ready by now. Okay. So this is the emulator. And so you can see that this is the emulator and emulator shows up in the DDMS. Okay. You can see all the running processes, all different processes are running, and you can see a log of what's happening. Okay. It's a log of all the error messages, debug messages, all kinds of stuff. You can see the file explorer, you can see the folder structure and so on of the device. Okay. You can do a lot of cool things like, let's say you want to send, you can send a phone call to the device. If you're testing some scenario, you can say call the device. And it will send a virtual call to your device. You can pick up the call and so on. Right? So you can send calls, you can send SMSs, send location details, you can check out. Let's say what are the threading parameters for this particular process, how long the thread has been awake, all kinds of detailed information about the device. So in case you're interested in what's happening on the device, the logs, anything, DDMS is what you have to get to. It's not there by default, but just click on add and get it. Okay, back to Java, let's run the program. So what you do is right click on the name of the program, run as, and dot application. So, any questions along? Okay. So, just before that, you can see the program we had edited. We added the button. It's come up over here. Simple. It's running. So, r.java again. r.java. Whenever you add any new resource, it can be any kind of resource. Android automatically catalogs it over here. Okay. And then you can use it in your code. You can use it to reference that same resource in your code. So I'll give you an example. Let's say somebody said that we want to check, you want to launch a new activity. Right? Let's quickly do that. Right? What happens is when this button is clicked, let's launch a new activity. Okay. First, let's create the activity. Activity should be created in a separate file, in a separate class. Right click, new, class. Okay. We'll call it my activity. Okay. Super class. It should extend activity. Okay. I'll just search for the activity. Okay. Click finish. It'll generate the class for you. Call activity. Okay. What should an activity also have?
On create.
Right. So you can't see this, but basically there's this folder called on the top there's a bar called source. On that you click on override. Okay. So what this does is gives you the ability to override any of the super class methods, right? So these are the activity methods that you can override. So on create will be over here. There's no shortcut by default, and you can't see it. So it's source, on the top source, override implement methods. Okay, file edit run source. Okay, source override. So you can override other methods also. Like I was talking about activity can be paused, right? So I'll show there's a pause. There is a restart, resume, start, stop. Lots of different methods you can override. You can see what's happening. So let's go back to main activity. So this is called my activity. Okay, you have to. Yeah.
So basically, these are already the inbuilt.
These are the super class methods.
I can just call
override
it and then.
Yeah.
So basically, when should activity start?
Yeah. So if you want to do any functionality when the activity starts, stops, resumes, whatever, you can do it. Okay. So on create, what happens in on create? In the other activity that you've seen,
call the layout.
You have to expand the layout basically, right? You go to this, you write this line, set content view r.layout.activity. So basically saying that the layout of the activity should be whatever's there in r.layout.activity. Okay, let's create a quick layout. Right click, new, android.xml file. There are many layouts to choose from. I'll just quickly choose a relative layout. We'll call it my activity layout. Something. I mean, you can call it whatever you want. Okay. It'll be created in the layout folder. Go to the graphical view. We'll drag and drop something. Let's say we drag and drop another button. Okay. We'll put it over here. Save it. And you can change the text also. Let's change the text to okay. So this is the XML tag, right? Like the element for the button. So there is a particular like Android text. Whatever you want the text to like say, you can change it over here. So go back to the graphical layout. You can see that's changed. So now this is a layout file, main activity. What should I write over here in main in my activity? So that the layout becomes the new layout. What should we write? What is the method?
I don't remember, it's in the other activity, right?
Set content, right? Set content view, what should be the
r dot layout dot
dot
my activity layout.
Okay, simple. Save it. Okay, what else need to be done for this activity to be recognized? Manifest file. Any activity, any building block has to be mentioned there. Okay. Go to the manifest file. Okay, I like to do it in code. Let me show you how to do it visually. So let's do it in code itself. So you need an activity tag. Okay. The name of the activity tag should be it. Okay. should be my activity. Okay, simple thing you have to define is basically what is the complete package name, the fully qualified name for the activity. Okay, comp.activity, I think it's the right one. Okay, simple. Any questions?
How have you linked this activity, my activity, to the main activity?
I have not linked it. Two separate activities, the second activity is not even being called. Okay? We've just defined it. Next. Okay. Now we have to launch the second activity, right? When the button is clicked. How do you get a reference to that button? This is where that r.id is useful. So let's quickly do that. Let's create a button. Button, we'll call it button 2. Again, you might get such errors, right? Many ways to resolve it, like you hover over it, and tell you how to quick fix it. So it's basically saying that this button is the button is not important. Right? Just click on import and we'll get fixed. What we'll do is now we'll have to reference that. So what have I done over here? I've created a blank button, right? Just a container, right? Is equal to, I'm finding the view. So this is a method called find view by ID. If you pass the ID of the button, which is what r.id.button2, you can call it whatever you want. You can change the ID as well. r.id.button2. If you give the ID, it will return the view. Now button is of type view. The super class, like the base class, is view, right? So any view you can get from this. Okay. It's going to return something of type view. You want to type cast as a type button if you want the button functionality. Okay. So you might have some text view, you might have edit text, you might have any kind of view basically, even view groups in your layout. If you want a reference to that, let's say if you have this a placeholder, right? Dynamically you want to add a button to the placeholder. So you get the reference to the placeholder, and then you can add stuff to it. Any questions here? Is that clear? Next, we'll create a listener, set on click listener. Okay. So what happens is you can attach a listener like any Java program, right? Attach a listener to the button. So whenever the button is clicked, it will be basically this listener will be invoked. Okay. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to write it from scratch again. This set on click listener. Okay. Inside the listener, we can dynamically create it like an anonymous inner class. Okay. Again, you'll get some errors. This is purely you've not imported the listener. Just import the listener and all the errors will be gone. So what I'm doing is I'm setting an on-click listener and the listener I'm like defining in real time. Okay, I'm defining it inside the bracket itself. And if you want to do something when the button is clicked, you have to define it over here. Okay, so anything you define over here, right, will be called when the button is clicked.
Name is
new
on-click listener and this is on-click.
Okay, yeah. So this is the same as doing something else. Let me quickly show you. So this is an anonymous inner class. So
this is the class defined.
Yeah, I'm just defining the class over there.
Okay. No, I thought you said. Okay.
It's the same thing, I'm overriding the method of that class. So let me do one thing, let me show a message, like a short message. So the method for that is toast. Okay. So let me show that. there's this method called Toast. What you do is it takes some parameters. First is the context. Okay, it's basically where you're launching the message. The message itself, I'm saying moving to activity 2. The length of the message. So there's a constant defined called length short for short duration. And the last method is first is for creating the toast. Dot show will basically show the toast. Okay. Let me quickly run this program and see what happens. There, you've not written any code for that, but that will be shown. Sure. Any questions? Cool? Okay. Now, what we'll do is what do we need to do to go to another activity?
Intent.
Remember, intent to move from activity to activity. We'll create a new intent. Okay, the first is where you're moving from. Okay, the second is the second activities class. Okay, you might get some error once again for importing stuff. The shortcut Command Shift on the Mac will import everything. The first one you might just want to use this. So moving from main activity to the second activity. Okay, this is just the intent. It's not actually doing anything with the intent. So what you would want to do is that activity. Okay. So use that intent to start another activity. Also, we'll show you how simple errors can happen and where you'll get what line number you're getting the error. So let's go back to our program. Okay, button. You click the button. See the error. So this is what I want to show you, the error where you can get the error. Right. So error. Any idea where you get the error? We had shown you in DDMS. Is the log of all the errors. Right. So this is very important. I wanted to show you. Okay. Unable to find explicit activity class in my activity. Have you defined it? Have you declared this activity Android manifest or XML? Yeah. Apparently, I have not defined it. Let's go back and check. get some very simple spelling mistakes, it will not fix it for you. So, okay. The cool thing is, if you go to DDMS, you find the line number at which you get the problem, right? You might get a detailed explanation like this, you might not. Okay. What, in case you encounter such a problem, just Google the error, right? Google from this place, right? And you'd get many Stack Overflow answers on any kind of errors. You also get a line number if you're lucky. So you get the line number, right? Mainactivity.java 27. So if you go to main activity and turn on line numbers, so you can see 27 is the start activity. Okay. Over here it tries to basically find that activity and so on. Let's try now. Goes into the second activity. Okay, so again, this is the layout for the second activity. It's completely different from the first one.
What was the error?
The error was that the spelling mistake. So we had not spelled the activity name properly in the manifest file. So it's not able to find it.
How do you look at the interactions? Like, so Android phones are all about sensor interactions.
Okay.
So would that be a part of the UI, or would that be part of the?
What kind of?
Let's say I give the part, so the moving from one activity to one activity, the interaction was like,
okay.
So this was on and that was
product. Okay, different animation. Sorry. Yeah. Animation, there's an animation framework. So there are various animations, you can pop it up and so on. So a couple of lines of code you have to write what kind of animation that you want to show.
So where does that
animation will go in when this activity starts. It will go in the first one, how do you want to make that disappear. This one, the appearance will be in a, you can define it in the XML also, like the animation that you want to have.
And
okay.
Animation inside of their activity would just go inside that particular.
Sure,
so
yeah.
Any button ID that's I just mentioned that.
Sure, sure, absolutely.
Line, yeah.
Exactly.
Animation.
Yeah. So any view that you have, right, like give a quick example. The button door. So you have this called start animation, right? If you define the animation, you can just do on any view or any kind of element. So any questions?
And the notifications as a whole is a particular application thing. So that would be main activity.
So wherever you want to show the notification, let's say you want to show the notification when the button is clicked, right? So you would probably write it like before this. After the stores, you might want to show a notification. So, two or three lines of code, you have to get a reference to something called a notification manager, and then using that, you can notify. Right? So, two lines of code, and you can show any notification.
So, let's say the particular notification is not an activity thing.
Okay.
It's more of an application thing.
Sure.
So, me getting an email or
sure. So, that is triggered from the service. So the service is running in the background. Let's say you're a music player, right? And you want the music controls to be in the notification center. So that is powered by the service. So service runs in the background. So like you would have the activity over here, like public class, main activity extends activity. That would extend service. Okay. There are lots of other methods that you have to override, like how the service is bound and so on. So, but then you have the ability to have notifications from there as well. So you can power it from there, you can switch it off. So.
And you were talking about fragments.
Okay, fragments, right? So, how can I show you a quick example? So, we'll create a new project. So, we close this project for now. In case you want to get back to your hacks, like, feel free to do so. So, we'll call this test. I'll just move it to a higher version of Android because some of the features we're going to try is a little higher. So what we're going to do is have navigation now. Okay. This is how it's going to look. So let me quickly make this and launch. So this has a couple of swipes. So if you swipe, you'll go to another screen. So that screen is no longer an activity. Okay. So as I showed you, right, like the whole thing is basically a screen. The whole thing is an activity. But in this case, when you swipe, it's not the whole screen that's changing. It's just the part of the screen. Right? So what happens is this is when you move, right? The screen is not changing. This part of the activity is changing. So this part is a fragment. This part. You can have smaller fragments, you can have bigger fragments. You can replace one fragment with the other in this case. So show you the code real quick. So it generates a lot of code for you already. So in the set content view, this is main activity extends fragment activity. Because it supports like fragment related features, so it extends fragment activity. It's still an activity. Inside that, in set content view, it sets it to, again, activity underscore main. If you go inside activity underscore main, you'll see that it's got something called view pager. Okay. So view pager is an element which can handle multiple fragments. So you swipe from page to page, it'll go from one page to the other page. Okay. It's got a title strip, that's the top part that you see, the name of the page, that's the title strip. And there is no definition of the pages itself, right? The page that you see inside, that's not defined here. That's defined separately. So if you go back to the activity, you can see that okay, this is the fragment, okay? And it's got its own view. Okay, that view is basically fragment underscore main underscore dummy. So you see this text view over here, it's like one text view with a number. So that is basically this fragment's text view. So each fragment has its own layout. Okay. So what this view page is doing is, it's creating multiple dummy fragments. And for each of those dummy fragments, it's when you're swiping, it'll expand that and show them. So
fragment is meant for tablets and everything. Big screens, right?
It's kind of associated with that because what happens is normally in this case, right, you just have one complete activity. You click on something, you go to another activity, right? The whole screen is redrawn, right? If you don't want the whole screen to be redrawn, you can have a particular section which is like a fragment. If you have a tablet, right, it's a bigger screen. So every time redrawing the whole screen doesn't make a lot of sense, right? So what you do is instead of redrawing the whole screen, you draw part of the screen. So that's part of the screen. That's why people associate fragments with tablets. So what happens is, for example, in a Twitter application, you might have two views, right? On the left hand, if it's in landscape mode, you might have the list of tweets on people on the left hand side, Gmail, list of mails, and the mail itself on the right hand side. When you switch it to portrait, only the detail of the mail will come, right? So in the landscape mode, the mail itself is part of the right fragment. The left is the list of mails. Okay. When you switch, instead of showing both the fragments, you just show the detail, like the other fragment you just don't use.
And so, in relation to what you said,
just
said, so right to whatever we have written, is it called a portrait or is it?
Yeah, this is, so we are not defining the portrait, that kind of functionality. This is a very simple fragment. Where you're just seeing that this page has this fragment. Right?
So how does it work if the user runs the device?
The whole screen will be like the same. It will occupy the whole
right. But if I want a different thing to happen,
correct.
How
if you want something different to happen, then you have to define a different layout basically. If you say that when it's portrait, don't show this layout, show some other layout. Okay. And in that layout, just show one fragment. So it can get more complex.
So basically the intent is it's shifting from portrait to landscape mode, and because of that intent, a different activity has.
It's not intent, so those are again different broadcast messages. Like, so activity will automatically handle these changes. Like there are these are called orientation changes. Like when you move the accelerometer, it will automatically note that it's gone from portrait to landscape or whatever. And activity will automatically redraw itself. Now, by default, you don't have to write any code. It will handle it, right? But if you want different design for portrait and landscape for most tablet apps, in that case, it's highly recommended that you handle it yourself and kind of show a different. Java, DDMS, yeah, mostly we've covered everything. Any questions?
Values, what does that mean?
Values contain something called strings and arrays and stuff.
So basically, so can I change this type? I've read somewhere
which
these would represent your normal CSS.
So values has many things. It has demens, strings, and styles. So demens is for dimensions. So again, you can have different values folders. You can see there are three different values folders, four, five different values folders. This V11, V14, SW600 DB, So these are different folders for different purposes. Like drawable has different folders, right? So these are called qualifiers. So you can have different qualifiers for values. So what this means is dimensions. So you might want some amount of padding, right? If you want the text to be somewhere on the left hand side, but you want to give it a padding, the padding will change on the device. Right? On a tablet, you might want more padding. So you can have dimensions. Okay, store the padding. For different dimensions, like different devices, you can have different dimensions. So you can SW600 dB means smallest width 600 dB. This is for Nexus 7. This thing identifies a Nexus 7 and higher. So if it's a Nexus 7, don't take the dimensions on the default value. Take the dimensions from the dimensions files in that folder. So you might, like, if you go to that folder and let's say dimension, right? So margin is 16 dB, like 16 elements on this device. On some other device, you might. Similarly, styles. Styles is like just like CSS, right? You can have different themes, you can have font customizations and colors and all that. Any style you want to give to a particular button or text, whatever you want to do, you can define this in XML. Completely different from the code inside, like just like CSS. Define it over here. And quickly, strings, right? Any idea why strings could be useful? Why would you store strings separately in the value store?
So static values?
Yeah.
Static values?
Yeah. Why would you store it over here?
So probably multiple language support.
Correct. So what could happen is, if you have values folder, multiple values folder, you can have, let's say, a French values folder, right? values-fr. What would happen is you would have the same string name, like the string name would still be app underscore name. Okay? But let's say the app's name is hello, right? In French, it wouldn't be hello, it would be something else. So you create the same string name, and the value inside of that, you put it in the other language, right? Support international, localization. You can have different values folders, you can have strings, you can have arrays as well, so you want different array values for different. Different languages, different areas, geographies, different screen sizes. V11, V14 is for different Android versions. So you might want different dimensions recently. Because the UI changes so much, you might want different dimensions or different strings.
In the layout XML, I have the button. I can change the button color there. And all.
Everything. Yeah.
But can I do, so what does this thing basically do the values here? How
it's just like HTML, right? You can put the style inside the element itself, or you can separate
the
CSS.
I can do this from
here and
there. Yeah, absolutely.
It's the same thing. So it is the button background. That's the one. If you want to change the background, you can change it to. We can make it like. You can change it and change the color to red, right? And you can change it again for code as well. If you go to code, if you get a reference to the button, you can change the background color from here. Same. And you can do it from styles as well. And then what you do is you can say that.
And if I do it all the three places, which one will be the one that gets done?
So if you do the So the styles and the ones in the button that get applied right away, the code gets executed later. Right? So by that I mean that so your layout is expanded over here. Okay. If you do the like code one after that, like set the color, so that's the last place that's getting called.
This file.
Yeah, because all the styles, everything is getting activated over.
But still, like, which one gets executed as which other two?
This is the last one. This is the first one that will get executed, right? This is the first line to be executed. So your styles plus the other stuff would get executed here. But if you have the button button two dot set color after that, so that will be the last one.
What's the best practice?
Best practice is styles. Use styles. So if you want to put styles over here, you can use the styles is equal to style.
Are there any better UI libraries already created for Android?
There are lots of UI libraries. Like there's something called Action Bar Sherlock, UI functionality library. So this top bar that you see, this bar, it's almost black, you can't see it. This is called the Action Bar, right? It's not there on older devices. So there's something called Action Bar Sherlock, which brings it to older devices. Lots of UI libraries, but like there's a site called AndroidViews.net. You want to see some third-party views? There are many
third-party views which are better than non-native views.
Yeah. So you can see this. They have all kinds of different views. So there's a progress fragment, page tab, message bar, graph library. Some if you're using graphs, right, you can use this graphing library. Any questions? Cool. In case you have any questions, just reach out to me.
Manual draw it in our website. Manual draw it in our
website. BLRDraw.org.
Okay. And one more thing,
sorry,
I repeat. Can you tell more about the fragment thing?
Fragment thing, okay. So in this example, right, this whole screen is an activity, right? You don't want to change every time you swipe the screen, you don't want to draw the whole thing again, right? It's only this part of the screen that you want to redraw. So fragment is a very efficient way of just assigning like the whole functionality into this part. Like you assign it a separate life cycle altogether. So this part is a fragment, right? When you click on something else, right, you swipe it, basically another fragment gets loaded. So you might have multiple fragments.
And can you show the code? Yeah. How is doing that when you swipe it? It must be clicking in the event, right?
No, the swiping functionality is handled by a view called ViewPager. You don't have to worry about that.
But did you import in this file ViewPager?
Yeah. It all created it by default when you click next in the wizard, it automatically did all that. So this is view pager, it has some adapters, some stuff. But basically what's happening is every time you swipe, it creates a dummy section fragment. And dummy section fragment over there in one creates view, it's gonna create the view. And that's the view that you'll be basically.
How did you create these buttons?
It's file new, it's in the wizard.
Okay.
File new Android application project. We give it some name. Next. You have navigation type.
Okay.
You just choose it and you create it. Okay, cool.
Thank you.
Okay, cool. Thank you.
So I've done designing as my classrooms.
Oh, okay.
दर्शन दर्शन
तू बोल
Thank you.
actually, you can understand it.